the broken things of life, broken relationships, shattered dreams, fractured hopes for people we love. What can we do about them? The living God is here, and He can take the broken pieces of our lives and give us an unbreakable peace. The reading of the Word of God is taken from portions of the Psalms, and one of the most challenging commissions that Jesus ever gave. Hear now the Word of God. In the 18th verse of the 34th Psalm, the psalmist says, "The Lord draws near to the brokenhearted, to those who are crushed in spirit." And in the first and third verses of the 147th Psalm, praise the Lord. It's a good thing to sing praises to our God, for He heals the brokenhearted. He binds up the wounded. And David wrote, "The sacrifices acceptable to God are a broken spirit. A broken and a contrite heart Thou wilt not despise, O God." And just before He left them, Jesus said to His disciples, "A new commandment I give unto you, that you should love one another even as I have loved you. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you love one another." Now let us pray together. Gracious, loving, forgiving, accepting God, healer with hope, you know the immense wounds of life, what can happen to us when life is fractured. Gracious God, touch us right now and make us whole. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A welding company put a slogan on its sign: "We weld everything except a broken heart." An honest admission coupled with a bold promise. How like most of us. We can do most everything with inventive genius and human skill, except one: heal a broken heart, our own or anyone else's. Suddenly we're galvanized together into a oneness, the kind of oneness that comes out of a common concern and a shared ache. Every one of us either has a broken heart, has had a broken heart, now submerged or sublimated, will have a broken heart before long, or know someone who has one. What can we do when life fractures us and pulls us apart? What do you do when your heart aches so much that you can't even pray? Where do you go when your heart is so broken you can't imagine that it could ever be healed and mended again? And then the question comes. It rumbles around inside of us. Finally, it reaches the foreplace of our brain and demands an answer. Does God know? And if he knows, does he care? And if he cares, why doesn't he do something about it? Does God really know when our hearts break? Yes. Yes. John Masefield put it marvelously in that wonderful poem, The Widow on By Street. And God who gives beginnings gives the end, a place for broken things to broke to mend. Where is that place? Everyone in the world cries out, where is that place for broken things to broke to mend? Jesus made it very clear. He said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another even as I have loved you. How has he loved us? Really? We can sing with pious joy. The love of Jesus, how can we know? None but his loved ones know. Why is it that some of his loved ones have broken hearts? How do you answer that? Does Jesus know when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth or song? Yes, we say. But what if we pray our glib prayer, Jesus loves me, this I know, and then put our head on the broken dreams that we have for a pillow? We really have to go much deeper in understanding what Jesus really meant when he said, even as I have loved you. That's the key. How has he loved us? To the uttermost. We'd better take this apart and put it into three aspects. What are the broken things of life, your life, mine? How does Jesus Christ heal the broken things to broke to mend? And then how are we to be wound healers in his name and in his style? The broken things of life, what are they for you? For many of us, they're broken dreams. Let me just suggest this, that the heart's desire is always the raw material of the heart's despair. The broken things too broke to mend are always related to those things or persons or places or positions or power that we set out ahead of us and do all of our hoping and dreaming and yearning and aching. We all know something about that. Every one of us has had a broken dream or two. I received a letter from a woman who watches our television program. Her husband of 20 years just had told her that he didn't want to live with her anymore. He had fallen in love with another woman and he was leaving. She said, all of my dreams are going down the drain. What am I going to do now? How would you have answered her? One man who identifies himself as 182532, simply a number in a prison, but he watches our program. Number 18, it's going to be all right. By God's grace, justice shall be done. But have you ever had an experience in your life when you felt unjustly maligned or misused or mistreated and it broke your heart? I have. A young woman came to see me. She's a junior in college, one of our local colleges. She had just been told by her fiancé that he was not interested in going on with the relationship, she said, "My whole dream was in that guy." What would you have told her? A couple came to see me and they said, "We've saved and we've scrimped and we've denied ourselves so that when we retire, we can have a relaxed time traveling. And we made an investment in an enterprise we thought was going to work, and it didn't, and we lost everything we had." And the woman looked at me and she said, "Where is Jesus now?" Good question. Some of the broken things too broke to mend in your life and mine have names on them. They're very, very personal. Oh, if I could only develop some kind of a plastic bubble to put over the lives of people I love, to keep everything away from them, to free them from worry and doubt and question and anxiety and frustration. There's nothing like the broken heart that comes out of concern for somebody you love. Does Jesus Christ know or do anything about that? Some of us have the broken things too broke to mend right in our own bodies, and we wonder, what can we do about it? Physical health breaks, we face surgery, nostrums become the most important part of our life, and we live from prescription to prescription. And it's almost as if the things we want and hope for most gurgle down the drain in mocking laughter. And what about when ties are broken and they become the pieces of the things too broke to mend? Some of the things too broke to mend have had names on them, and I've watched the caskets lowered into the ground, loved ones, family members. Never forget a time when I did a funeral and went out to the graveside, and on top of the casket was a new wreath. It had one word on it with a question mark at the end. Why? A young mother who now had to raise three small children had purchased it and had given the orders that it be placed there at the very last moment. Very often we wrap up our whole lives in another person. Person to whom we're married, some friend, someone who works for us or for whom we work, and the whole thrust of our being becomes that person. But what about the broken pieces too broke to mend that are in the broken relationships of life? What about the enemies that we've tucked down inside of us and still hate with a virulent poison? Remember the Spanish patriot, Havarez? He went to his confessor and the priest said to him, "General, tell me about your enemies." And he says, "I don't have any." "You don't have any?" He said, "I've killed them all." Well, the 100-year-old man who said, "Let me tell you the secret of my life. I'm 100 years old and I don't have any enemies." And somebody said, "How did you get there without any enemies?" He said, "I've outlived them all." But what do you do when deep inside of you, you carry the burden of things that were said, when you're misunderstood and maligned, when people have misinterpreted you, misused you, and twisted you, and your whole life becomes the memory of that thing? We can build that up so much that there's no energy left to live. The broken things too broke to mend. And how does Jesus help us? How does he love us in that, to teach us how we are to love other people realistically? I think I abhor glibness more than anything else. Pious phrases that never touch the realities of life. To say Jesus loves you must be coupled with the realization of what he can do in the extremities of the broken things too broke to mend. Let me put it in a hard way, a hardness that heals. Stay with me. The only way to heal the broken things too broke to mend is brokenness. You say that's redundant and contradictory. Not according to the scriptures. The psalmist could say that the Lord draws near to the broken in heart. He heals the spirit of those who are crushed. The Lord binds up the wounded. Surely Jesus included the first verse of the 61st chapter of Isaiah when he stated his purpose there in Nazareth, that the Lord has sent me to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted. But do you know how God does it? Through brokenness. David found that out when he tried self-pity and then self-incrimination and then self-hatred. He finally got to the place where God gave him the secret for his broken thing too broke to mend. And it was in brokenness. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart thou wilt not despise, O God. In every broken thing too broke to mend, there is that crucial transition point when finally it must be surrendered to God, released to Him. For He hammers, as the great man Smith who knows us better than we know ourselves, until we become the people we were meant to be. He does not send tragedy, but He uses it. He does not punish with difficulties, but He uses them to shape us. That's the wonder of it. We are to love as Jesus loved us. Listen. In Gethsemane, before He went to the cross, He got down on His knees and He said, Father, if this cup could be taken from me, and all of history hung in the balance in one word, nevertheless. And then He said it, and He gave us the key for the broken things too broke to mend. He said, nevertheless, thy will and not mine be done. You see, the cross is not only the assurance of the love and the forgiveness of God. The cross holds a secret. We are to be crucified with Christ. And that means the death of ourselves, our own dreams, our own wishes, our own plans, our own clutching hold on the future. And the longer I live in Jesus Christ, the more I realize that when my heart is broken, the Lord has drawn near, and He can use that to help me draw closer to Him. Think of the broken dreams. It's usually when we've made a diminutive God out of something or someone. It must be broken. Think of the loss of someone we love. Grief finally gets to the place that we clutch it more than we should. Dickens' character in the gin shop was right. In his cockney, direct way, he could say, healing broken bones never heal anyone. A good person's hard to get. You better take care of them while you got them. That's what grief is. Not having taken care of them when you had them. And yet there comes a point when you have to let go and give it to God and allow His healing streams to invade it. Same thing is true in terms of our forgiveness of one another. There is no limit to which we are to go in the name of Jesus Christ. That's what it means to be a follower of Him. There's no hurt that has been done to us that we can cherish as our own source of indignant judgment. We are to be initiative lovers. We offer God the grapes of our own failures and hurts, and they're not marbles, they're grapes. And He crushes them so that we can be wine, poured out wine for the hurt of the world. You see, Once you've experienced the healing of a broken heart, then you are a member of the choice shock troops of the Lord. Because now you have a vulnerability and an openness and a tenderness and a freedom no one else has. People have had enough judgment, enough indignant rules, and enough evasive equivocation. What they need now are people who have hurt enough to listen and care and share out of their own vulnerability what Jesus Christ can do. And that's the genius and the wonder of what God can do with broken things, too broke to mend. We finally discover that the place where that healing takes place is in the very heart of God, expressed on Calvary for you and me. Oh, love that will not let me go, I yield my weary soul to thee. I give thee back the life I owe, that in thine ocean depths its flow may richer, fuller be. O light that followest all my way, I yield my flickering torch to thee. That's what it means. Finally, when the Spirit of God takes what we thought we could not endure and through it gives us a new beginning. What is it for you? What do you need to give to Him now as the expression of your own contrite and broken heart? Your willingness to trust Him in spite of everything, and your desire to join with Him in identifying, caring, listening, and encouraging the brokenhearted. There is a place for things too broke to mend. The cross.